African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning, everybody. There's one Wahlbergs Eagle. There's another one just to its right-hand side, and you are watching Safari Live.
Ready.
Standing by.
Hello everybody, we've just had the most amazing start to the day, haven't we? Two beautiful Wahlbergs Eagles, the pale form pair that lives here, not ironically, on Wahlbergs Eagles Nest Road. And just before you came live, they mated. Listen. That's the female calling. They mated on that branch. And we've been sitting here for about 10 minutes now. First of all, she popped down and she picked up a piece of stick or grass or something to reline the nest, flew up onto the top of the nest. He came and sat around here. Then they sort of got closer and closer. And then just before you went live, he sat down next to her. And they, well, hopefully will be making another little Wahlberg fairly soon. I don't think they successfully raised a chick last year. In fact, I'm 90% sure they didn't. So that's quite interesting. And such a recognizable pair, of course, because they are both the pale form. That's him, that's the male. Look, look, look. She's going to fetch another stick. Piece of gwari bush. Oh, that's wonderful to watch. Isn't that incredible? Now, just to keep you posted, my name is James Henry. Jandre is on camera. I'm not sure what that Wahlbergs Eagle's name is, but we can give it our own name if you like. On the other vehicle, Jamie Patterson, who's following up on the lions that Chris Rogue spotted at the pan. Thank you, Chris, for that. We're going to maybe follow up on the leopard that you heard at 5:30 calling, sawing away. No lions as yet. Jamie is being filmed by David, who managed to get out of bed on time today. Miraculous. And in the final control, Louise Pavide is being ably assisted by Geraldine, the dislocated knee, Kent. And we'd love to hear from you during the course of the morning. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv if you're on the email. The first one was for Twitter. I think this is just the most spectacular way to start a day. It's a misty morning, you know. You can see the mist in the background there. And when I got up, I could smell moisture in the air. It seems to be, it's a very strange tree for a Wahlbergs Eagle to be sitting on. I mean, it's not exactly a robust piece of wood. She's sort of dangling on a piece of gwari bush. And I imagine she's probably eyeing out some of the dead sticks there, thinking about whether or not to take one for her nest, you know. It's a bit like shopping for interiors. You know, Jandre, when you go and you shop for a new sofa or something like that. Here she comes. I wonder why she's taking it there. That is wonderful. Well done, Jandre.
Yeah.
I, of course, didn't manage to get a photograph, but that's not surprising. All right, I'm going to sit here for a little while longer, everybody, if you don't mind. Let's go across to Jamie and find out what's happening with her lion tracking.
Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie and I have Dazzling Dave on camera with me. And the lions have pulled a sneaky maneuver. Where on earth have they gone? I can't work it out. Now Dave and myself raced out when we heard that they were drinking at the Juma Dam Pan. They've got to be somewhere here. They've gone into the drainage system between where we are here and, which is on Vulture's Nest, and the dam itself. So they're somewhere in here. They haven't popped out yet. And the question is, have they just decided to go and lie down in the drainage line itself? Where are you, lions? I can't understand it. We must have been 2 seconds behind them. And we just missed out on finding them. But never fear, I am determined this morning. Yesterday afternoon on the sunset safari, we were looking in completely the wrong place. Let's just put it that way, right up until the very last sort of 45 minutes of the drive, at which point it was starting to get a little bit too dark to go walking after lions through thick vegetation with, oh, cubs. Hello. You're not a lion, but you are an equally pleasant surprise. Do you perhaps know where the lions are? Oh, what a lovely way to start, with a spotted hyena. Who have we got here? That's okay, you can come past. A hungry-looking spotted hyena. Oh, with a thorn in it. No, just an itchy chin. Thought it had a thorn in its foot. One of my absolutely favourite animals, definitely my favourite predator to sit and spend time with. And yet, we have been relatively deserted by our spotted hyenas of late, though it's always a very pleasant surprise to see one. You must know where the lions are. I bet you do. Those of you with your spot comparisons handy, which hyena are we looking at here? Let's come wandering past. My guess is a male. In fact, I'm relatively certain we've got a male coming through. Slightly smaller than the females. And definitely on the mission to see if it can find some food. We go and keep up with it a little bit. We know that those lions must be ready to eat soon, in the next few days. That buffalo carcass is now almost a week. It was almost a week ago that they had it, so they must be feeling a little bit empty-bellied, and perhaps they did manage to kill something. They might have killed something small last night, and the hyenas on the lookout for it. Where did you go? Try and stick with him, and at the same time listen for alarm calls that might give away the presence of the lions. There he goes, into the block between Vulture's Nest and Nyala Road South. Might just be going on a walk, seeing what it can find. And the males play a very important role in terms of patrolling a hyena clan's territory. They might not be the most dominant members of it, but they spend a lot of time whooping and calling to other hyenas to let them know that this is their clan territory. As well as anal pasting and marking in the latrines. So a latrine is basically a toilet spot, although it serves a very, very important function in hyena life. Can I get around? I think so. Okay, well, Vulture's Nest is becoming very familiar to me now. Having now... Just let me see which way this hyena's going. There he goes there. This is now the third time we have driven down Vulture's Nest Road. I can tell you that round the next corner there are two male impala. They haven't seen the lions, I asked. Oh yes, a latrine is basically a toilet spot for hyenas, but it also serves as a marker in terms of their territorial areas. And a good place to stop and anal paste as well, which carries all kinds of interesting information for if you happen to be a hyena with a hyena's sensitive nose, in terms of marking territory, indicating the reproductive status of that particular individual, its clan status. Hello, Impala. Yes, it's me again. Hello. Yes, I know. I wonder if they're looking at me thinking, what on earth is this idiot woman doing? Hello. Yes. Good morning again. Have you seen the lions yet? No?
Good morning, Mobile Station.
They must be terribly confounded. Okay, I'm going to sneak past these hyena and go and catch up with that. What? I'm going to sneak past these impala and go catch up with the hyena. I'm not sure what sentence just came out of my mouth, but while I try and regather my thoughts and my ability to speak English, let's go and have a look at the sunrise with James.
Now, Jean-André has pointed out something rather interesting to me there. You see, in the middle of the sun, slightly to the left and top, there are two darkish spots. Well, Jandri reckons those are sunspots. So I said, don't talk rubbish, man. They're dirt on your lens. And then he said, no, no, but watch how they move with the sun. And indeed he is correct, which pains me to say, but he is. Those seem to be two black sunspots. Isn't that cool? Jandri, are they in focus?
Mm-hmm.
Are you sure?
100%.
I think that's just fantastic. We haven't moved at all. We're just enjoying the Wahlbergs Eagles at the moment. Mrs. Wahlberg has gone back to the nest with her piece of guari bush. Oh, that's very beautiful, Jandre.
Yeah.
Yes. I especially like the aerial on the left right hand side there. It's very attractive. Yes, I agree, Louise. The bend of the aerial fits very nicely with the sort of turn of the tree. Delightful. How artistic of us. Now, let's stop being silly about that. She's in there. You may just see her head bobbing up every so often. There she is, doing a bit of vacuuming, some hoovering. She's perhaps putting the coffee machine on. You know, even in the bird world, a woman's work is never done. There she is, slaving away, preparing the nest for the little eggy. He's just lounging about, watching the sunrise. Go on, you lounger. Go and help. It's 2016. It's no good that you just leave her to do all the housework. See, he's now ashamed, everyone. That's why he's hiding his face from us. Hello, Boyd. You say, do these eagles mate for life? Boyd, you're in North Carolina, and they do mate for life. Well, they mate monogamously. Whether it's a lifelong pair bond, I'm not sure anybody really knows. So, I mean, these chaps come back together every year. But if one of them died, I'm pretty sure that they would, they'd get over it and move on, basically. And I don't know that it would last for their whole lives. I mean, they're quite long-lived eagles, probably about 20 to 25 years they can live. Oh, that's wonderful. Isn't that wonderful? So, Boyd, I think they're probably nominally monogamous, but they won't necessarily stay monogamous forever. So they're monogamous, but is it a lifelong pair bond? Probably not quite as strictly. That is just wonderful, to have a bird on the ground like that. Isn't that amazing? So beautiful. Now, it's not a big eagle, everybody. They are not large. Probably, what should we say? Maybe about a foot and a half long. Maybe 2 feet if they're lucky. Some of them can reach 2 feet, apparently. I just don't want to move the car at the moment. I think he might get it, or she might get a fright. Oh, that's he. Look, he's taken our advice, everybody. He's gone to help with a bit of the housework. Good for him. Modern fellow that he is. You see how modern he is, Jandre. Oh, that was beautiful, hey? So, curious one, you said they work like the bald eagle does, which is of course the American national bird. You say he will go and rearrange what she does in the nest. Well, I think that's probably quite possible. Have they got... they don't have two nests in there, do they? Mm-mm. One second, let me just take my binoculars out. They do have two nests in there. That's the one they're using at the moment. There's an older one underneath that, though. That's quite interesting. I believe I haven't noticed that before. In the background, everybody, the call of the... very far in the background, the call of the turkey-like ground hornbill. It's a much more lively morning today than yesterday. Oh, that's very beautiful indeed, Jandri. You can just see the mist starting to burn off. Thankfully, we have a little bit of golden hour today. Yesterday, we had no golden hour. We just had blinding white heat from almost the beginning of the day. He's back on the ground, Jandri. I don't know what he thinks he's going to find. Oh, he's found another stick. Clever fellow. I think this is just marvellous. Hello, Shamsun. You say he seems to be a bit picky with regard to his sticks. Well, so I suppose he probably is. He likes that one, though. He probably has to be quite picky, you know. He doesn't want to incur her wrath. He certainly seems to be indecisive, Shamsun, I would say. There he goes, walking across. Not a hopper. Remember, like the yellow-throated Petronia we saw yesterday? I don't know if you remember that, everybody, but one of the distinguishing features of the yellow-throated Petronia, unlike other sparrows, is that it doesn't hop on the ground, it walks. So it is with the Wahlbergs Eagle. I'm rather excitedly wait there. They look so graceful. They look so graceful when they are when they're flying, but not so much when they're sort of waddling across the sky, at least across the ground. Come on, take off, fellow. I'm going to take a picture of you. No, missed it, obviously. Listen to them talking to each other. Hello, yard bird in Arizona. You say, might the eagles take different sticks from different trees during different times of the nest production? Yes, I imagine they might, you know. What they're doing there, of course, the main part of the nest is made of broken knobthorn sticks, it looks like. But what I think they're doing now is collecting those gwarri bushes to line the nest to give it a little bit of softness before they lay the actual egg. But most of these raptors' nests are very rough sort of stick platforms. But I think they are lining it a little bit with some green leaves, which will hopefully make it a bit softer for young master or Miss Wahlberg when they are eventually hatched from the egg. All right, Jandra, I think that's enough of Wahlbergs. Let's go and find some lions, shall we? Or a leopard. Oh, that's a good idea. James, Richard and Robin B, you want to know if we can look at the Wahlbergs' tracks? Well, I believe, yes, we probably can. Let's just ease our way down the road here. And try not to drive over them. Which, if you're me, is not impossible. He was standing sort of on the corner here. The southern boo-boo calling. Nice shot. I'm just going to look, while you look at the birds, I'm just going to look around here and see if I can't, sorry, Jandre, see if I can't spot the tracks. Which I don't seem to be able to at this stage. I wonder if they're not going to mate again, everyone. Just watch carefully. It's quite sweet. Look at that. Aloe preening, it's called. In any other language, it's known as a tickling or whispering sweet nothings into your partner's ear. What do you think he's saying, Jandre? I think he's saying, what a beautiful sunrise, my dear. So many years we've been coming back here and just never gets tired, does it? No, my dear, it's really spectacular again. What are those strange people doing, pointing lenses at us? It feels very odd, watched like this. I feel like a voyeur. Oh, don't worry, my dear. They're here all the time. That's really quite sweet, that, isn't it? That is a marvellous picture. Hey? Something tells me he or she, I can't tell which, is not quite satisfied with the tickling he's had. Wants a bit more. There we are. Yes. Very sweet. Isn't that nice? That is so cool. And there's something about watching animals be affectionate with each other, I think, that touches the cockles of our anthropomorphic hearts. Makes it look rather more human when they're sitting being affectionate like that. Especially as they're birds, which I guess we consider, a bit of a yawn there, we consider to be quite far distantly related to us, you know, much more so than, say, lions or leopards or certainly the primates. And so when something so distantly related behaves in a human fashion, I think it's really fascinating. Hello, David in Napa. You want to know how many eggs they're going to lay? I nearly said sell. They probably won't sell any. They will lay two eggs, one of which almost certainly will not hatch. Now, I'm just going to jump out of the car and see if we can't get a picture of the tracks. I don't want to move. Well, let me ease down the road. I might not have to get out. I just don't want to give them a fright because they're being so very confiding to us. Oh, there's a track. It's not a particularly impressive one. Jandre, I don't know if... Can you see the leaf there?
Yes.
Just behind the leaf. Is a track on the ground.
That pale
minty green one. Yes. Yeah. And there, the back. Don't just tilt down a bit. Tilt and pan to the left. There. There you are, chaps. I would get out normally and show it to you, but I think they'll get a bit of a fright, so we'll just sit here. And that, everybody, is the track of the Wahlbergs Eagles. So should you be wandering in the bush, wherever you happen to be, and you see that, well, look up in the sky. For Mr. and Mrs. Wahlberg are sure to be close by. All right, let's head across to Jamie, get an update from her. I was going to go off sort of in that direction to try and find the leopard that was sawing at 5:30, but Rexon's gone to do that. No one's found the lions yet, so I think we'll just go and give Jamie a hand and Taxon as well. Okay, see you shortly.
James and myself are going to try and track down these lions for you. It's an absolute mystery to me what's going on. I didn't realize it was just cubs that had come through to the dam to have a drink or to come underneath the dam camera, which definitely changes my approach. I'm not going to go racing off into the bushes. just because it's funny to watch. And it gives me a chance to try and listen for contact calls. Come on, one more time. Aw, got all camera shy. Crested Franklins were giving us their dawn chorus. Nope, all done. So, as the lion cubs start to get older, they're starting to get more adventurous. Now, we saw it the other day when Dave jumped off the vehicle at Cheetah Plains to stretch his legs, only to be... Are you just waiting for me to start to talk and then call? Okay, are we done now? Yes. Yes, so Dave got off to stretch his legs, only to be frantically told by me to get back into the car because there were lion cubs racing towards him. No sign of the adult. I must admit my heart rate went up a little bit at that particular moment. So the lion cubs start to get more adventurous and they start to move away from the adults, and sometimes they get lost. They get a little bit overly keen about where they think their parents are going, and they go racing off ahead, and then all of a sudden go, uh-oh, I don't know where everybody is, and then they start to, oh, there they are. Surely that's them. Oh, no. I think is that a lion or a log? Oh, no, it's a log. Or is it? Can you see where I'm looking, Dave? Go forward a little bit. Just zoom in. I can't see where I'm looking now. Oh, it's the one, I think it's the log on the right. I thought that was a lion. I got very excited. No, it's definitely a log. Definitely a log. Is that what I saw? No, that's definitely a log. Whoops. Whoopsie daisy. Okay, that's now happened to Dave and myself this morning. It's the dangers of specifically or trying to rack your brains to try and see one thing. And then you start to see it everywhere. When you're looking for lions, you start to see lions everywhere. It's a dangerous, dangerous thing to start to do. Whoopsie. Sorry. False alarm. We're just cruising past where James was earlier with the Wahlbergs Eagles. I can't find any lion tracks going out of the drainage line, so perhaps it might be worth taking the little two-track into the Mawati drainage itself and investigating somewhere there. Maybe they're around. Might be able to spot them. The vegetation is nice and open, though we should be able to see. What I was also trying to listen for was that... It's difficult because it's very, very soft, but when lionesses and their cubs become separated and they start to make that gentle ooh, ooh sound, it's very, very soft and gentle, which makes it a lot harder to hear. There's a lion cub. Oh, little ones, are you lost? Hello. It's not a log this time, it's a lion cub. Oh, shame. Let's just stop far from them because they're lost. Oh, dearie me. 1, 2, 3, 4 little faces. Oh, shame. Do you know that we're right where James stopped? Oh, little ones. Oh, no. You're not lost. You're not lost at all. I can see an adult coming behind you. Oh, hi. I've got the lions in my pimpuns, Twin Dams Junction, Wahlbergs Road. Hello? Hello? Aren't you gorgeous? James is going to be most upset. This is exactly where he was with the... I'm sitting underneath the Wahlbergs Eagle. Look at you. Oh, latecomer. Trot, 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 trot. How absolutely magical. Here comes another one. I can hear the adults calling to them. So they've just run a little bit ahead of Mom.
Hey, Jamie.
Oh, this is such a magic scene. Look at you. Oh my goodness gracious. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the lionesses making their way towards us as well. What a beautiful scene we are being treated to. Ah, magic. Hello. Here come our lovely Nkuhuma ladies, marching up behind the cubs. I've only counted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 cubs, but I'm sure the other two are just hanging back. Oh! Amber eyes. Amber eyes, you're bullying that cub. Got into trouble from Mom there. Magic. Amber eyes tends to be a little bit skittish with us in the vehicle, so we'll just keep our movements nice and slow. Oh, big yawn. Isn't this absolutely stunning? All rushing towards the jungle gym that is a fallen tree with Amber eyes walking right past Dave. This is stunning. Oh, absolutely magical. Our perfect little... Ooh, be careful of running at Amber eyes. She'll give you a smack. Amber eyes is the best aunt. She's great. She's so much fun. I'm just waiting for a moment before we reposition and switch on the vehicle. Just to make sure that they are not too close to us so we don't give anybody a fright. How many females have come past? 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, we should have all 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here comes the remaining one. I wonder if they're on the lookout for the 2 remaining cubs. I definitely only counted 6 initially. I'm not too concerned at the moment. I think that 2 of them just got a little bit over-eager. Raced to the dam and then had a minor panic when they realized that they were all alone. And here comes the final lioness, walking down the road towards us. Hello, girl. Empty bellies means that the Nkumas have not eaten in a little while. And especially for the lactating females, they're going to be feeling a little bit hungry. Sure. You're going to rub your cheek against the side of the car there, girl. Awesome. Does that feeling ever get old, Dave? Don't think so. We would never ever get that close to a lioness. She chose to get that close to us. She chose to walk that distance. You can see the cubs gambling off in the distance. Let's go and turn around now. We can. All lionesses have come past. Yay! Success! It had to happen at some point. you know, going round and round and round the same spot. Poor James, if he just waited with those Wahlbergs Eagles for 2 more seconds, he would have had them. I mean, we really are, we're right underneath them. Our station's the Zingala now mobile north along Twin Dams towards the Pan. What a nice way to start off a morning. Hello, ladies. Stop here so that we don't block off the rest of them from the pride. Perhaps I'm biased, but I feel as though the Nkuhumas are particularly good-looking lions. I'm talking about the lionesses themselves. And they're very, very big girls. And despite the empty bellies, looking in particularly good condition. Okay. Just hear the sounds of the cubs. I want to try and get ahead of them. And Safari Hayes, you're wondering if perhaps the mums had to bring along everybody else to find the missing two. Yes, I think there's a good chance that is what happened. Come on, we can do this. I'm just taking a quick shortcut to get ahead of them. And hopefully we can have another view of them wandering down the road towards us. Yes, I think mums did have to gather everybody to go and collect the two absent cubs. Oh, this is such a cool way to start a day. Oh, you're so fast. Look at you go. Amber Eyes keeps smacking the cubs.
I also like to respond to which one in Gala, if it's the gap there.
The best. Just knock it over and move off. Chichi, you were wondering how old the cub was that was being bullied by Amber Eyes. You say bullied, I say being taught some very important life lessons by Amber Eyes. I can't remember which one it was, or I didn't actually see which one it was. I think it was one of the youngest ones, in which case they are, what are they now? They must be coming up to 3 months, 2.5 months old. We're just so incredibly fortunate with these. We've got three different age groups. We've got some lion cubs close to 4 months, and then the middle set that are just under, and then the youngest set, which must be, no, I'm exaggerating, they're probably about 2.5 months old, the youngest set. I must try and remember now exactly when they were born, roughly when they were born. The scenes of Amber Eyes playing is just magnificent. Now, unfortunately, our time with them is limited. I just want to chat to Andrew on the Game Drive channel. Andrew, what's your position?
Andrew.
Andrew, I know you said you were interested in responding. I just wondered what your position is.
I'm a shooter craft line, central. I'm still way out there.
Okay, copy. They're on their way towards Wojtyla Dam now. I will keep you updated. Just let me know when you're a bit closer and I'll pull out for you.
Okay, good, thanks. I'll let you know.
Oh, little one. You can see the youngest one. One of the youngest ones there. Oh, they are too gorgeous for words. With your enormous feet. Are you going to be enormous? One day when you're big. Oh, it's an intimidating sight, isn't it, Dave? We're being watched closely by fearsome predators. Sort of. Two, three, four, five, six. There's definitely only six cubs. So I don't think the other two have been found yet. I think the females are looking for them. They know that they came this way. Brenda in Virginia, I think the two are still missing. I'm not sure why the lionesses haven't called to them yet. Perhaps they've been calling and they heard the cubs' response from this direction, so they thought they were here still. I'm not concerned at the moment, although we did have that hyena. He was quite far away from where we are now and where the cubs were seen. But I'm hoping we're going to get happy scenes of reunion soon. It is a dangerous world for little lion cubs to be out on their own. I'm not quite sure why they decided that it was a good idea to go sprinting off ahead of the rest of the pride. Not the most sensible decision in the world. Oh, hold on. Oh no, that's a lioness. I just saw a flash of tawny. Trying to work out which ones are missing. It's one of the older sets and one of the younger sets. I wonder if they must realize that they're missing some. Surely. This is such a beautiful scene. Absolutely magical. I'm just going to make space for Aubrey to go ahead of us so that his guests can enjoy the magic of the sighting as well. There's one lady standing on the deck of Wojtyla watching the scene unfold in front of her. Hi guys. Morning. Okay. I'm going to follow behind him. Little cubs, I wonder if the lions realized just how close they came to seeing the missing two. It's always difficult because, of course, we can't hear as well as the lions can, so we don't know what's being said between them. We don't know whether or not they've realized that the cubs are or were just here. Perhaps they already know where they are and they've told them to wait for them to go and have a drink and then... that's me taking my foot off the brake. Oh, look at that. Just little heads underneath the adults. Do you get a more iconic shot than that? This is so incredibly beautiful. Here comes, slowly but surely, there is a fifth lioness. She is just a little way behind. Perhaps she has realized that there are cubs missing. Oh, so beautiful. All accompanied by the sound of a yellow billed hornbill. Look at those precious little faces. And the amber eyes always stands out so distinctly. Oh. No, Mom, leave me alone. I'm trying to drink here. Faces covered in dirty water. Oh, somebody's got wet feet. We've been treated to scenes like this before. The lionesses get terribly anxious with their cubs around the edge of the water. And they try and move them away. Obviously an instinctive concern about crocodiles, or presumably an instinctive concern about crocodiles, trying to keep them safe and together. And the cub's obviously having a tantrum because they're just thirsty. Now covered in mud. That little one is determined to go back for a drink, despite Mom's best efforts. One of the oldest cubs drinking in front, and then the youngest one's at the back. Your faces.
Bobby, are these the babies of those three now?
Brent said it best when he said, there's certain sightings that just don't need words. Okay. The lionesses are starting to call now. Look at these. Yeah. The lionesses are calling now. I hear that lots of you are getting some amazing screenshots. This really is too beautiful. No, we're still thirsty. We're still thirsty. Despite Mom's best efforts. Practicing the skills they're gonna need one day when they're big. Right now it's just a fun game. That little one is covered in mud. On the one hand, they've got faces that are just the picture of innocence, and on the other, then they're mischievous little bundles of fluff. I think. Now I'm trying to keep track. The missing cubs might have just come out. These poor cubs, they just want to have a drink, Mom. There's no crocodiles there, it's okay. So determined. Wait till Mom's back is turned and then I'll go and have a drink. Get 5.6. It's as wide as. See what's happening over there. One, two, three, four, five, six. No, I've still only got six cups here. It's hard to know where to look, isn't it, Dave? There's so much going on. That female is the one that's calling, the one with the cubs. I suppose it gets difficult to keep track of all the little cubs. But they must surely have realized there's two missing. Oh, such thirsty lions. I love those little moments when the coordination doesn't quite work and there's a little bit of a stumble or a trip. And just a little casual reminder for new viewers that have just jumped on board, as if this needed to be any more mind-boggling, it is live from the middle of the African bush. You're watching five lionesses and six cubs quench their thirst at a dam, live from South Africa. Mind-boggling concept.
Rick.
This is so magical. Excuse me.
Hello, Jim. The shuffle here dropped to the flat reach of that junction. I need a road. Yeah, Vulture's Nest, Road of Central. It could be for you guys.
Yeah, positive monkey for the guys as I was working on Hyena Road, thanks.
And just next to the little central there.
Where are you off to, little one?
Behind me, so
going on an adventure.
So maybe if you get hold of it.
Okay, thanks.
The world is the little cub's playground, and even a stick will do as a toy. Ooh, someone's gonna pounce. William, in Oregon. Yes, it could be that they're drinking a lot because they are hungry. And I'm sorry, I just need to chat to Andrew. I know he's on his way to the sighting, so unfortunately our time is limited. So William, I'll answer that properly in a moment. Andrew, standing by.
Hi, Jamie. I'm on the...
Make your way. I will pull out for you.
Give me thanks.
Where are you going, Gums?
Jamie, what is the local state in Galana?
Okay. Try for one last view before we have to move out for Andrew.
Yeah.
Oh, that was so special. We will return once everybody else has had a chance to see these lions, provided, of course, they don't disappear into some thick vegetation. But we will be coming back. They're slowly making their way towards the Vuyatela dam wall.
Okay, come with thanks. I'm by the Rhino region here, so you want me to wait a bit?
Come through, Andrew. And they're going to start moving into the Mawati, I think.
Okay.
Last views of the cubs before we have to move off. And William, sorry, just to finish off very quickly with your question, it could well be, as you know, a lot of the time when you are, well, I know that when you're hungry, you, or sorry, when you're thirsty, you actually think that you're hungry. Just six. There were two earlier this morning on the dam camera, but there's six now.
Right, copy, thanks. Come slowly
outside. Copy. Okay, guys, unfortunately, it's time for us to say goodbye to the lovely little cubs. We'll be back a little bit later. I'm going to, while we leave the sighting and chat on the game drive comms, I'm going to send you back over to James, and hopefully we will catch up with you and these lions shortly.
News from this end of the reserve is that Karula crossed into Juma and then she went out again sometime during the night. Now maybe she has murdered something and it is sitting in a tree up here, perhaps hanging, waiting for her to collect the babies. Maybe that is the case. We hope it is. The other thing I managed to find for you was a very, very attractive moth which, just as you came live, absconded. I had him sitting in my box here. And I don't know where he's gone. Anyway, that's all we've managed to find so far. Also one diker and some crested barbets. Otherwise it's just been a very pleasant sort of morning watching the mist lift as you have been enjoying the lions. How very nice that is, and how very deeply unfair of them to pop out exactly where we were looking at the Wahlbergs Eagle. One does feel slightly embarrassed when that happens. Now, one bird that we've been talking a lot about over the last little while is the yellow-throated apalis. And there's another pair calling here. And we tried to get a shot yesterday. Let's just stop and listen for a second. But the shot we got yesterday, there were two that we watched, but they were very cross with each other, and so they were flying all over the place. I just heard them here going... While we wait and see if they call again, oh, I was going to say, let's have a look at that grey go-away bird, but it is now gone away. No, they've stopped calling. Okay, let's go around the corner, because I want to see again if we can... yesterday we had one of those very rare moments for me in the bush where something predictable happened. I said, I'm going to try and call the pearl-spotted owls in this area. Turned off the car, made the whistle... Bang, the owl arrived. So let's see if we can do it again, twice in a row. The other reason for driving this road is that Karula's tracks went up towards here and then back south again. So if she has maybe killed, well, probably around here. One can live in hope. She's been very remiss about letting me watch her babies grow up of late. I shall have a word with her when I next see her. Some waterbuck over there. Right, now Gendre, we're going to stop here and we're going to make the call of the pearl-spotted owl, unless we can see him. I think they're out hunting, Gendre. Never happens twice, does it? Oh. Oh well, let's carry on. Thank you, Louise. Yes, she says better luck next time. Quite. Now, let's just keep an eye on all the tops of the trees here. See if the queen has hoisted something. She does like this area when she comes north onto Vuyatela. It may have just been a territorial sort of patrol that she was doing. So we'll just peer under the bushes and into the tops of the trees. Now, the light you can see is changing already from that lovely golden dawn light to the rather more harsh white light of this time of the year. And I'm going to ask Luisi, do you know what the maximum temperature is going to be today, Luisi? 47, 44, 34. I had some indications from Gendre. Unfortunately, his sign language is very poor, so he was unable to say. 34 degrees Celsius, 93 degrees Fahrenheit, apparently. It's gonna be a cooker. Right, no elephant, at least no leopard tracks. I'm so sorry, Dina. You say I woke your cockatiel with my owl call. I'm very sorry. Cockatiel actually will probably learn the owl call. I've taught a cockatiel a call once. I had a girlfriend who owned a cockatiel, which when it came to live with me, on account of her disappearing somewhere, I released from its cage and it lived in the room. And it used to imitate all the whistles I did. What have you seen, Gendre? Not a leopard. Oh. All right, we'll look at your roller. There is the roller, everybody. Spotted by Gendre. I'll do the call once more of the owl in case they've come towards Treehouse Dam. Not sure why they would have. Prior to the deluge, it's a bit of a dust bowl. Nothing but a stony silence, Gendre. Up in the top of that tree there was a grey-headed sparrow. It's not particularly astounding. Can you see it there? Let's just look at it for sake of completeness, so that we have seen both sparrow species in the last 24 hours. The other one being, of course, the... There we go. Can you hear it, everyone? Yeah, I don't think you probably can. It's way behind us. I think there's also an elephant just up ahead. The other sparrow, before I get totally distracted, was the yellow-throated Petronia. I think there's an elephant here. I just heard some crashing of bushes. Can you see one? Ah, many. Hello, Hayden in California. You're wondering how many bird calls I can do and how often I practice them. Well, Hayden, I spend about an hour a day sitting in my room practicing bird calls. You've got to warm the lips. Number of stretching exercises. And then there are some words that you should say to really warm them up. Of course, the favorite being Benedict Cumberbatch. Benedict Cumberbatch. Once you've said that 10 times, you're ready to go. And then one must sit and make various tones of whistle, one various squawks. There's this sort of squawking call, the whistling call, and the, what should we say, the sort of peacock type call. And you need to practice each of those for exactly 20 minutes each a day. I'm talking absolute nonsense, of course. I don't practice them at all. I don't know how many I can do, not many. I just like to try doing them. There's some elephants up ahead. The really difficult ones are the clicks. But the peacock, quite easy, don't you think, Gendre? Exactly. Shut up. There's an elephant cow and her wee calf. There, Gendre, not me. I don't look like an elephant. And they're almost onto a diet entirely based on the cambium layer of cumbritum trees now. Not much else for the elephants to eat. Now, I have been going on about the fact that I thought that the elephants were not looking particularly fly as a result of the drought, that they were looking a little bit skinnier than some of the others. But it seems to vary between herds, you know. Some herds seem to be looking a bit better than others. Jean-André made mention of the fact yesterday that he thought some of the elephants that were seen on cheetah plains 2 days ago were heading into the Kruger to perhaps some patches of feeding. I'm extrapolating now from what he said, because it would be far too complimentary to him to say that he had thought this. But perhaps to patches of unknown vegetation to some. You know, some might know of different feeding patches that others don't. And I think that's quite likely. I think this cow looks pretty good. She's not looking quite as thin as some of the others I've seen. She's definitely still lactating. You might just be able to see there. So she's still suckling that little calf she's got. And there are about 10 or 15, I think, elephants around here. They're all very silent and almost invisible in this grey, sort of droughtish, dry season vegetation. I'm going to go around the corner to the gendarme and see if we can't see some of the others. If it's all the same to you. Let's just pop around here. Some youngsters. It's not great for Jean-André, but he'll have to make do for now. And the coppery gold of those leaves versus the grey of the elephant. I love it. Hello, Justin. You want to know how good my elephant call is? Well, Justin, it's exceptional, I think. I'll do it for you. Here we go. Justin, although that is what an elephant call sounds like to our ears, sort of, I don't think it sounds anything like that to their ears, because it is such low frequency. So I think we're only hearing the top part of what noises they make at that very low frequency, which I think is quite interesting. So I think growling at an elephant like I've just done now will not in fact result in some form of communication. Obviously the trumpeting noise one can make. That sounded much more like mosquito flatulence that it did than it did an elephant's trumpet. So peaceful now, everyone. Just a couple of birds calling around the place. You can hear the white crested helmet shrikes as they fly along. Drongo's clearly following each individual elephant in this herd. Just hear them very subtly in the bush. Crombex, possibly the odd fire finch, which is a beautiful red finch. And then the very soft footfall of the elephants, much softer than any other animal, really. Except perhaps something tiny like a dike or a Steenbok. And the gentle snapping of twigs and things. Hello, William in Oregon. You want to know if elephants see in colour? William, I don't think that they do. I'm pretty sure that they see in shades of non-colour. I don't think it's black and white. It seems to be much more likely I can never remember this, but I think it's shades of blue and green. That's what they see in. So it's not black and white, it's blue and green, but they won't see the yellows and reds and things that we see. And that is to improve their night vision, basically. That's why they would be. I suspect they're probably more colour aware than, say, lions or leopards, which have to see exceptionally well at night. But I don't think they see colour like we see colour, or like most of the birds see colour. Let's go a little bit forward. It's going to be a little bit of a bump as we drive over an enormous elephant dung. There we go. Flat squish dung now. Be perfect for Steph, actually. It's very fresh. He'd love to have a drink of elephant dung in the morning. This is young elephant, either genuinely scared or just sort of messing about. I'm going with messing about at this stage. Also the chinspot battis in the background. And then different kinds of chinspot battis calls. So the normal one is the one I've just done for you. E flat, D, C. That's what they do. But there's some that just go on the same note, some that go. And the southern black tit. There are lots of birds today. Now the rest of the herd is coming out from the left-hand side there, so let's have a look at them. I think let's give them... Well, I'm just going to sneak forward a little bit before they cross the road, Jandro. Sorry, Susan, I completely missed your question. Can we have it again? The game drive channel was going in my ear. There we go. Now, Susan, you're wondering about the size of the elephant herds that frequent the area here. Well, in theory, Susan, you'll read 10 to 15, but I think sort of 8 is round about the average size of the small herds we get here. Lots of different herds of roughly 8 or so animals, I think, is about the norm. I took a picture, Jandro. It's a horrible one, but I took one. And this is a young cow in front of us. No, Louise, you may not see my picture. It'd be ridiculous. Is it a young cow? No, it's a young bull. That's why he's flapped his trunk over his tusk like that. Now look, coming across the road here, carrying a stick. Hello, little fellow. I'm definitely going to take a picture of you. He touched the car. Did you see that? That's not very good of him. And Mrs. didn't mind in the slightest. She's just eating her breakfast. Getting it a bit stuck on things. She's probably the matriarch of the little herd, just making sure that we're not sort of going to chase them or, you know, create any sort of consternation. So she's letting them move off into the bush. This, of course, is completely anthropomorphic thinking, but I think that's what's going on. At the same time, she's probably just checking us out, got a little tired of carrying that branch around. And so she's just going to eat it while she watches us and makes sure we're up to... up to no ill. There she goes. Oh, that's great. What a marvelously peaceful, delightful sighting to have with elephants when they are so clearly at peace with us and not worried about us at all. Beautiful. We're going to let them carry on there. We can't go into the bush after them, so we'll just keep going along here. No further tracks of Kurula or anyone else. All right, let's go and get an update from Jamie after her wonderful lion sighting. Perhaps she's spotted some leopards where we were looking at the crested barbets.
No pressure, James. I haven't spotted a leopard. I'm sorry. I'm sorry to disappoint you. No leopards here. Now, I've just chatted to Rexon, who tells me that at least one leopard crossed south into Little Gowrie, and it looks like it was a male, so probably Tingana, came through Juma last night and then went a little bit further to the south. I know that the guides also reported hearing a leopard calling around Vubu Road. I'm not sure what happened with that particular leopard. I've sort of trundled up into that direction just to have a little look. Perhaps Mbula has decided to return to Juma, but no luck so far. And I've just heard that there is space at the lion cub sighting again, and I know, of course, everybody's concerned about those two missing cubs. I am as well. I'm sure they're fine. They're most likely absolutely fine. It's just a matter of them finding their way back towards Mom and the rest of the pride. So that's where we're going now. We're slowly trundling back. I say slowly. My foot's getting heavier the more I think about them. Trundling back towards that lion sighting. I think Dave and I are still riding that high. It is absolutely stunning. First thing in the morning with the golden light, little lion cubs drinking, faces full of mud. Oh, I'm so spoilt. And we call this work. Rexon says that he thinks there was a little kill, a small kill that the lions had around Vulture's Nest, which is interesting, because they didn't look as though they'd eaten terribly much, so it must have been something really small, because those bodies were particularly empty. If they did have a kill, it must have been something like a small Nyala or maybe an Impala, something that five lionesses and eight cubs would go through in a heartbeat. But that might explain why the little cubs were so thirsty that they dashed ahead of the rest of the pride. I think they just dashed ahead because they're cubs and they get distracted with each other and they go racing off and then suddenly realize, oh my goodness, we're all alone, we have no idea where we are. Well, we know where we are, but we don't know where everybody else is, and it gets a little bit terrifying. And kind of like losing a child in a shopping mall, you want them to stay in one place and they don't necessarily do that. And Shamsun, they should be able to pick up the scent of the cubs, I would imagine, with their incredibly sensitive sense of smell. The difficulty is they've been spending so much time... Oh my goodness! Hello, kudu! We found all the kudu on Juma. How lovely. What a nice surprise. I said all the kudu on Juma. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Such beautiful antelope. Just to finish off Shamsun's question while I go and reposition to get a better view of the kudu. I would have thought so. You'd think that they could smell the cubs. Most important, though, is going to be the contact calls, and those cubs are going to start to yowl when they realize just how lost they really are. They might even be back there already. We'll have to go and rejoin that sighting to find out. Oh, we've got some zebra here as well. Perhaps the pregnant one is amongst them. Yesterday, on the sunset safari, we saw a female zebra not too far from where we are now that was positively bulging at the sides and clearly going to give birth in the next few days. And we discussed the possibility of spending lots and lots of time with her. She was unfortunately on the northern side of our boundary. And the prospect of another live zebra birth would be quite spectacular.
Crossing to Beverly Street from Short Point.
Grazing away. I'm going to... I don't want to. But no, I do want to. I do want to leave these zebra. They are lovely. But what I don't want to happen is for the lions to be left without anybody watching them and then have a chance to disappear where we don't know exactly where it is they've gone. So I'm going to keep going. Just get us back to that sighting. I don't think that's going to happen. I think Tax is still with them. He's a lovely kudu. And welcome to Dalava, who is a new viewer joining us for the first time on our live safaris, or one of the, certainly the first time I've ever heard your name. It's lovely to have you, and I do hope that you become as addicted as everybody else is to our incredible live safaris. Now, you wanted to know how close is this to the real thing? The answer is as close as you can get, because it is, of course, completely live. In terms of the difference, we probably spend longer with the animals than you might if you were on a real safari. And that's just because if you're on a real safari, your time to see all the different animals is limited. Sorry, got distracted by the game drive channel. So it is, it's very, very truly reflective, but we don't have to rush between different sightings. Sometimes the guides get guests that... They get guests that are only there for 2 or 3 days at a time, and then obviously they feel under pressure to show them leopards and lions and elephants and everything that you could see out here. We get to stop and spend a little bit more time with the beautiful things like our kudu. Observe their behavior. That's probably the main difference. Plus, you don't have to be too cold or too hot when you're watching from the comfort of wherever it is that you happen to be watching from. The magic, I feel, of Safari Live is that we get to follow the story of the animals not for 3 days or 2 weeks, but for weeks and months and years at a time. Some of our viewers have been following the story of Karula, for example, since her birth, essentially. And the fact that we get to spend time with all of the animals means that we get to see all kinds of things like the hunts, the sad moments, the happy moments. Where else in the world? You certainly wouldn't be able to watch lion cubs growing up if you came as a safari guest. You'd have one or two sightings with them and you'd enjoy it. And yes, it's magic seeing it in the flesh, but you wouldn't get to watch them grow up in the way that we have. I mean, we've seen the youngest set of Nkuhuma cubs since they were only a couple of days old. Their ears were still flat against their heads. Their eyes had only just opened. They were just... they were described as little sausages. Little fluffy sausages that sort of didn't do very much and wandered around and called a little bit. Now we get to see them bouncing around, getting battered about by their Auntie Amber eyes. It really is truly magical. So that, I think, is the magic of Safari Live. The ability to follow stories for extended periods of time and also to watch the bush change. To go through the seasonal changes. Very soon we're going to be up to our eyeballs in little bouncing Impala lambs, which is always a special time of year. Whoopsie daisy, I forgot how to drive. I'm going to go back towards those lions while I do. Let's go to James and some really beautiful birds.
There we are. Green wood hoopoe there with its very obvious red bill, which is why it used to be called the red-billed wood hoopoe. Jean-André, they're just up a little bit out of the bushes there to the right-hand side of where you're filming now. That's it. Well done. Now, they live in a flock, a little bit like a pack of wild dogs or wolves, really, where they have an alpha and a beta female. At least an alpha male and an alpha female, they are the only ones that will breed. And then the youngsters from the previous clutch, the year before's clutch, will hang around to help raise the new clutch. And that's quite a large bird. I mean, that's probably about a foot and a bit tall, so 12 or 15 inches. And that's them calling. And if you watch carefully now, you can see, and it's quite rare to see this, you can see how that bill is used. It's a probing bill. A probing beak, And that is the alpha female of the red-billed wood hoopoe flock there. Much larger, as you can see, than the rest of the flock, and more terrestrial. That is obviously not the case. It is a Steenbok. A male Steenbokie. Oh, and I can hear the elephants that we saw earlier just coming through this area. Let's go a little bit forward after the Steenbok sighting. Not the wood hoopoe sighting. The wood hoopoes are going into the apple leaf over here, and the elephants are popping through here. Ah, James Richard, you want to know about the apelis, and whether we saw the yellow-throated apelis or indeed the yellow-breasted apelis, because you say the yellow-throated is endemic to Malawi. James Richard, you may be correct, I'm not I seem to recall it being called the yellow-breasted, actually. Let me check for you, I'm now completely confused. Thank you very much for that, James Richard. It is the yellow-breasted apelis, yes. So if I said yellow-throated, I apologize profusely. I shall flagellate myself on return home. Now, is that the same bird there, Jandre? Or is it a different... No, it's the same species. It's a slightly younger one. You can see the bill is much shorter, and you can see it probing away there. So, yellow-breasted apelis. Thank you, James Richard, for that. There we go. Oh, look, you see the male is still following them down on the ground there. There it is. Amazing. Sexual dimorphism. Now, this little Steenbokie, they're all becoming a lot more confiding over the last little while, and I think it's because they're becoming much more risk takers as they must find things to eat. Now, Jandri, up on the marula tree. Oh, no, never mind, stay there. Hello, Lisa. You're wondering how long that the animals will start to show improvement after the rains have fallen. I think with some of the grazers, it's almost immediate, you know. They just need... So, let's say it rained yesterday. You'd have a flush of green today, and in 2 days' time, you'd have a decent amount for animals to eat. And I think a few days, just a day or two after that, they'd start to look a little bit better, and certainly they'd feel better. It's a little bit like with us, you know, if you are very hungry, if you haven't had vitamin C, say, for some time, and you're short of a nutrient, if you have it, it's very quick for your body to process it. And they start to look better very quickly. There we go. Now, a Steenbok, of course, has got to eat very concentrated food to maintain the very high metabolic rate it must. So that's why it is being so selective. It's not just picking up anything it can find, and like a buffalo. It's looking for specific corms, and which are sort of mini tubers, if you like, rhizomes, which are underground stems of grasses, and perhaps the odd stolon. If it can find some fruit at this time of the year, there we go, it's digging for those corms. You see that? I haven't seen that before. That's wonderful to see. A digging Steenbok. I would love to know what exactly he's digging up. Are we maxed out there on the lens, Jandri? How cool is that? Chandra, you don't seem overwhelmed by the coolness of the sighting. I'm going to go and look there. Where is it? Actually, she can't see it. Okay, now I can see it. I was looking at my monitor. Let's let him walk off, everyone. Then I'm going to go and walk there and see what he's found. Is he still digging? No.
Yes.
He is. Terror. He's heard something. No. Hey. At the same time, I'm not leaving here before I've gone to see what he was digging for. There. That's enough space. Let me go and look. He is definitely going to skedaddle, everyone, but he'll come back. Don't worry. Right. Can you direct me, Jandre? Fear not, little Steenbok. I shan't be long. In here? I've got it. Quite a deep now. Quite a deep hole, 3 inches or so deep. This is really cool. If he needs to dig away, tell me. It shall be a minute or two. It's a bit of sort of bulb, everyone. See there? What are you laughing at? It's a bulb, but it's gooey. See that? It's a gooey bulb. And I could spend a bit of time, I suppose, digging the whole thing up. But that's what the Steenbok was eating. How cool is that? That's a little bulb. How knew it was there, I don't know. Jandre, wipe that smile off your face. What are you laughing about? You know what he's giggling at, everybody? He's just giggling like a small school child. I should put him through a Sisyphus and find out how funny he thinks that is. Ha ha ha. All right, let's carry on. That's actually really nice to see, I think. Jandre thinks it's hilarious. Let's go across to Jamie, who's back with... What are you laughing at?
Back with the little cubbies indeed, and unfortunately, I'm afraid to say, still only 6 heads poking out from between the tambuati trees, the tambuati thicket that we find ourselves in. The lionesses don't look concerned at all. They just look a little bit dozy. And we'll have to just wait and see if the conquering cubs decide to return. This is the direction they disappeared off into. And perhaps the lionesses are just waiting for them to find their way back. Little ones, scenes of peace. Ha! Got you, fly! Sorry, there's a fly that's been trying to crawl into my ears and my eyes. It's gone now. Yes, scenes of peace and tranquility here with our lovely lion family. just the little niggling noises of the cubs as they settle in to suckle and have a drink. We've got the three mothers lying all together. Amber Eyes has taken herself off into the distance, away from the niggling cubs, so that she doesn't have to deal with them, constantly climbing on top of her. I think she is wise to the ways of the lion cubs. And she knows when she wants to doze, she'll have to be slightly separate from everybody else. Now, Gigi, you're wondering on the subject of Amber Eyes, who is, of course, for us, I think, the most distinctive of the lionesses, just because she's got orange eyes. You wanted to know how old, or whether or not we have any idea as to how old she is. If I had to guess, I would put her at about 7 or so years old. It's difficult to gauge the exact age of a lioness. One of the ways that you can is to have a look at their noses. And before everybody gets too cross, yes, I know that that's dependent on genetics, so sometimes old lionesses manage to keep their nose pink, but for the most part, out here, lionesses' noses, or all lions' noses, start to darken with age, and when they're about 50% covered in black, then you're looking at a lioness that is around, sort of, 5 to 6 years old, and that's just exposure to the sun. The best way to age a lion is to have a look at their canines. I've asked Amber Eyes if I could come and examine her teeth. She said no, and I took her at her word. Now, if I had to put her, I would say 6 or 7. She's older than lionesses. The youngest one was only recently upgraded from her sub-adult age, or her sub-adult term. Amber Eyes is actually making her way back towards one of the cubs, having just said that she was separate from them all. So, giving one of the lionesses a sniff. Oh, Fleming grimacing. Amber Eyes is an interesting female. We've seen her mating before with... I should probably clarify. I don't think this is distinct to Amber Eyes. It's just interesting that both examples have been with her. We've seen her mating before with a male, before she returned to one of her pride mates and then started mock-mounting her. It was one of the lactating females, so one of the females with cubs, and it was just an interesting example of animal behavior. And she's just gone and phlegm and grimaced at one of the females as well, and basically drawing the scent up into the roof of her mouth where the organ of Jacobson sits, actually officially known as the vomeral nasal organ, that allows her to taste the smell. Ah, oh, nice head rub there. Oh, going to lie on top of you. Flop. It's obviously been a long night. Here we go. Have a look at Amber Eyes' nose. Oh, goodness, I nearly fell over. You can see that's relatively dark. In fact, it's almost black. There's a little bit of pink patches still sticking out. I think that she's probably in the region of about 6 or so. It's still slightly pink, but there's black dots covering it. I do think that she's older than the two youngest mothers of the cubs. The oldest member of the Nkuhumas is also one of the mothers. She's the mother of the middle set of cubs. She's been nicknamed the grey-faced lioness before, and she apparently is the sort of the oldest surviving member of the Nkuhumas and the mother of all of the rest of the lionesses, mother or aunt of the rest of the Nkuhuma lionesses. They are hungry, so they're still on alert, and despite the fact that they look peaceful and resting now in the shade, if anything does come wandering through, there's a very, very good chance that they could get up and hunt. They might even be waiting for the opportunity when buffalo come to drink at the pan. I've never known a trifling thing like a hot day to stop the Nkuhumas from hunting. The young lioness coming to join the group. The youngest of the Nkuhumas. Oh, exhausted. Pile of lions. I'm Still desperately looking around every now and again to see whether or not the cubs decide to wander back through in this direction. This is exactly where they went off, which does seem to support Shamsun's idea or question about whether or not the lionesses could smell them. They've gone off in exactly the same direction the cubs have gone. They haven't managed to reunite just yet. While our lions sleep away the morning, let's jump on board with James very quickly to have a look at which bird he has to show you.
Now, it's not the most amazing bird in the whole universe. It's not a great colourful parrot or a vast eagle with amazing talons and vicious beak. It is the humble, rattling cisticola, but it is so close to us. It's only about 3 meters away, and it's just sitting sunning itself. And Louise said, is it on a nest? And I said, oh no, it's not, because interestingly, this bird, and I only realized this last year, embarrassingly, nests on the ground underneath a bush in a little sort of cup of vegetation. But it could well be thinking about building a nest underneath the Sisyphus bush in which it's sitting. And I just thought we'd never get to have a look at them like this. And so I thought I'd bring you across here, take you away from the lions very briefly to see the humble, rattling cisticola. Isn't he sweet? I'm sure he's on just about all of your bird lists, but I doubt anyone's seen him this clearly before. There we are. All right, everyone, we'll hand you back to Jamie and the lions.
How beautiful is this picture? Now you've just had a beautiful picture of a cisticola. Now you've got a beautiful picture of one sleepy cub and one sleepy lioness. Just let the Franklins finish their conversation. Now we are going to have to give up this particular spot. There is another vehicle on their way towards us. And since we've got the best view in the house, it is only fair that we share it with other people. So at some point we will shuffle around and make space for them. It is the only place where you can come through and have a view of the lions. Anywhere else is going to be a bit more tricky. But for us, it's okay because we've got the camera, which of course gets us places that human eyes cannot take us. Which is the other magical thing about these live safaris. There we go, that's one of the differences. Unless you look through binoculars constantly, our cameras can get you views that perhaps you might not get when you're out on a real life safari. Sally, if you guys stand by there, I'll just give you my position. It's the best view. Okay, we're going to have to just move out. And while we do, Chris Rogue, you were wondering if all of the lionesses are here or if we have a scouting team out. And the answer is no. No scouting teams at the moment, although that does often happen with the Nkuhumas. Just concentrate on getting back. All five lionesses are present and accounted for. So what often happens is, because cubs and hunting don't really go well, terribly well together, usually makes life a bit more tricky. So what often happens is some of the lionesses will move off. No problem. Enjoy. Yeah, we'll just let the other vehicle move in there. So yes, they'll send out a hunting party, essentially. I'm just going to wait for their engine to be off and then we'll reposition. And essentially what I'm trying to do is make sure that we've only got one engine on at a time in the sighting. It just minimizes the amount of disturbance that we have for these animals. On these animals. Any tambourines? No. Any lionesses or cubs? No. Oh, lovely. We've still got a perfect view. How's your view there, Dad? Perfect. Here we go. I keep redoing a head count just to make sure that I have counted correctly, but I definitely have. There's only 6 cubs here. Desperately rooting for the other 2 to make their way back safely. What a special scene. So there's 4 lionesses there, Chris, and then there's 1 a little bit off to the right, not far away at all, that is suckling one of the cubs. There you go, on the right there. So all 5 Nkuhumas present and accounted for. Which does make me wonder. Yesterday we were with the Birmingham boys, we were 3 of the Birmingham boys, and we had a report that one of them was mating with the female in Buffelshoek. Now the fact that we've got all 5 Nkuhumas here today doesn't preclude the fact that it could have been an Nkuhuma lioness, but there's also a possibility that it was one of the other lionesses, potentially from one of the northern prides that we don't get to see. So the Telemartes or the Torchwood Pride, both of whom have been known to move about that area every now and again. It's possible that one of the Nkuhumas came back and joined the group last night. I don't think so though, not judging by the tracks. We've done a full circuit of that area and I didn't see any tracks of a single lioness coming in. I think all 5 of them have been together the whole time. We're going to be looking back on these days in the next few months and remembering just how adorable these cubs truly were. Suggested that perhaps the cubs got lost just a little bit in their race to get to water. Susan was wondering whether or not the cubs would ever follow one of the males by mistake. And yes, potentially for a little while, if one of the males started to move off and thought that was the direction that everybody was going in, they could go gambling off with a male only to realize that that was an error and turn around and go back to the lionesses. What always confuses me a little bit is how it is that the lionesses, when they see a cub disappearing off into a direction, that they don't call it back or go and fetch it. And I guess it just becomes quite tricky when you've got to have eyes. I mean, those of you who have raised children or have grandchildren, you'll know what it's like with just 1 child trying to keep track of it. I suppose 8 of them, even when there's 5 of you, it's a bit like taking a classroom full of children to a zoo or something. I've always had complete admiration for teachers and their ability to keep track of all of their small charges. Perhaps being a lioness is much the same. So cute. A really nice comparison between the tiny little paws of the cub and then the massive paw of the lioness behind it. Amber eyes at the back and the little cub in front. And there's something so wonderful about their oversized feet. And they keep tripping over. So incredibly cute. Beautiful comparison between the size of the female and the cubs. This is one of the older cubs, I think, or perhaps the middle cub. And vastly different. I mean, that cub, the size of the lioness's head on the right is about the size of half the cub. And I know it's very difficult to get a sort of sense of scale or comparison. Realize just how massive these cats really are. It's only when they walk right next to our vehicle, like the lionesses did this morning, that you really truly get an idea. It's also phenomenal how fast these little cubs grow. Cataclysm has put forward a lovely suggestion that perhaps the cubs, the two missing cubs, are grounded for being a little bit too adventurous and have been done to keep them occupied. I will say one thing, I bet the lionesses, if they could have one of those puppy cages, not cages, but those sort of fenced off areas, I bet they would be so happy. If they could just safely pop those cubs there and leave them for a little while and have a little bit of peace and solitude. I have no doubt they would do that if they could. That, of course, is what a den site is, but cubs don't stay in the den site once they're past the six-week period. And just remember, I mean, we're getting very concerned about the two missing ones, that the little cubs, all of them, have survived at least 6 weeks being left constantly by their mothers in different areas, just like the strainage lion. So before we get too worried, they've survived as long as they have, they're probably going to be absolutely fine. And Ak was absolutely right. Having cubs must be like herding cats. In fact, that's exactly what having cubs is. And in this case, having just seen them drink and be covered in mud, herding wet cats. I don't envy the lionesses their jobs. Constant nibbling sharp teeth. The lionesses must just be so relieved the cubs are having a nap now. And while they do sleep the morning away, let's go back over to James, who has another bird for you.
Indeed, everybody, indubitably, it is a red yellow-billed hornbill. Just a yellow-billed, not red-yellow. And he's fossicking about in the elephant dung, picking up ants. It's going to be quiet for a second. I thought I might have heard some Impala alarm calling. We're in the area where Rexon thought he last heard the leopard calling this morning. And I have seen not hide nor hair or track or claw scratch of leopards so far. This is the most gorgeously peaceful morning. There, now we were asked a little bit earlier about how often the bird calls get practiced. Well, the Crested Franklin, a very difficult bird call to do, everybody. You have to practice that for at least 15 minutes a day. Now, I can't hear the Impala anymore. Hello, road wrangler. You want me to do a kookaburra call? I'm afraid I don't think I've ever heard a kookaburra. Gendre, you've heard a kookaburra call. Could you make the call for us, please? Yoof. Really?
They do something weird like that, but then they also have this amazing laugh, which I wouldn't begin to replicate.
Right. Okay, so in short, no, off-road wrangler, we can't do the kookaburra call for you. I'm sorry about that. Gendre went, ha 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 ha, but I don't know, not sure that that's what you were after, perhaps. Yeah, let's go around, if I can start the car. We're going to head towards Sydney's Dam, see if there isn't something around there. There should at least be a track of a leopard that was calling around here earlier today. It could have been Karula, you know. She could easily have made a come up here, done a territorial patrol, and then headed back south across the border. Maybe it was a male, maybe it was Tingana come through here, maybe it was Mvula come through here, maybe Mchila is trying to set up a new territory for herself in these vicinities, given the lack of Karula for the last little while. Ah, Chris, you want to know what a leopard sounds like? Well, it depends what it's doing. If it's marking its territory, it makes a sawing sound as such. Something like that. A lot more throaty than that, though. Then if it's very cross with you and it's chasing you or charging, or indeed if it's mating, it goes... And that's what a leopard sounds like. It also makes one other sound. It's a chuffing sound. And the chuffing sound is the sound that it makes when it's talking to its youngsters. So when Karula is trying to call the babies, she goes... It's quite an interesting sound to watch them make. There's a Cape Glossy starling that was sitting beautifully and is now not anymore. So let's just go up and see if there isn't something in these clearings that was causing consternation for the Impalas. The three young, or the three male lions that were here yesterday that Jamie saw during the drive, they went herring down towards the south. They've gone into Hoffman's and possibly towards Mala Mala to go and extend their range. I don't know where the other Birmingham boy is. I fear me they need to stick together a bit more, do these Birmingham boys, if they're going to maintain as a force to be reckoned with. No, I don't see anything here. And I also fear I've taken my jersey off slightly too soon. It's a little bit blowy. Chilly breeze coming in, which is very nice. I've no doubt it will die sometime during the course of the morning. Now, I can't see the Impala that was shouting or indeed anything else. Let's just go a little bit closer around the corner here. And then we'll make our way to the waterhole. No. I also want to know where our jackals have gone, everyone. The side-striped jackals that used to live in this clearing. They took up residence very briefly and then they disappeared. And I think it's rather sad because they're quite fun to watch. It's Hornbill City here, Jandre. Yeah, this is where the lions came from. See over here? I suppose that thing's... Is that any good for you? Not anymore. Let me sneak forward. There we are. Guys, reports of those three males on Hoffman's earlier. I'm just helping Taxon and Aubrey, who seem to be trying to follow the tracks of those male lions, unaware that they'd crossed. Isn't that lovely? We're having a great birding morning today. Starting off with the incredible Wahlbergs Eagles. Do you think he was fooled, Andre? Andrew Francis was very good at talking to hornbills, everyone. You've got him there.
He's a bit far.
He's a bit far, isn't he? That's not the best hornbill view we've ever had. No. Let's carry on. Before we carry on, though, I know a number of you are interested in their tracks. Justin, you want to know if I have any idea what the sound of the first human being was? Well, it depends entirely on what your definition of a human being is, I suppose. No, I don't have any idea, but I imagine the first human ancestor, say the first bipedal human ancestor, would have made sounds very similar to those of the chimpanzee. And slowly that we would have diverged as our voice boxes became more sophisticated and our tongues became more useful and our lips became sort of more able to move around. But I am not sure what kind of sounds Ugg the caveman made other than grunts. But I don't know. Now, what's interesting here, there are two things. Can you see this, Rondo? Mm-hmm. The hornbill has been digging in a hole here, which I think has been created by, well, ants, probably. And that's, you can see where his beak's been touching the ground. And here, and this is interesting because it's not easy to notice, and unless you know what's made this track, you wouldn't know that it was a hornbill. You can't see any definition of the feet, but that's them there. This is a hornbill moving. Isn't that cool? If you see that, you'd never pick that as a bird, would you? Especially in the sand. And it's because they move like this. I'll show you when Gendre comes back up towards me. They move kind of sideways, and their toes stick together. They don't open out like other birds. And they sort of move sideways like this. So their feet don't walk next to each other like that. They walk one behind the other, and one sort of in front of the other like that. It's a bizarre kind of method of locomotion on the ground. Yeah, somebody's quite impressed by that little story. Yes, indeed, Louise, you're absolutely correct. She says it's almost like they walk like a fencer. That's exactly how they walk. Just like that. I'm glad we got to see that. That's a really interesting track to see. And I imagine, because I didn't know what it was for years, well, not years, but quite a long time. I kept seeing the track and I didn't know what it was until I watched a hornbill moving and then went to see it. And that's actually the best way to... Sandy patch is the little denuded of animals, but as soon as the rain falls here, this will go green in, yeah, less than 24 hours almost. And we're all hedging our bets for the rains, of course. I said, what have you got? Oh, Chandra, that is a very good spot. A monkey. How did you see it, Chandra? The velvet monkey, everybody. Not the velvet monkey. We were discussing the other day where the term velvet comes from, and nobody's really very sure, but they are closely related to something called a green monkey. And we think maybe it's a mistake from the French, or the word verdant meaning green, and eventually it became velvet. Now they are climbing around in a tree, everybody, that even one branch of which you would be unable to carry in your hands because they're so thorny. It's a knobthorn. And I don't know how it is that these monkeys don't feel an exceptional sense of pain. Look at the one, if you can, the one to the left, Chandra. It's got a big, its cheek pouch is full of fruit. I don't know what fruit, but it's found some source of something delicious to eat. See what he's eating. Could be jackalberries from an, but I don't know where he would have got those around here. Maybe old bits of root like that Steenbok was eating. Oh look, they're eating the flowers. The one on the right there is eating the flowers of the, that's really interesting, the flowers of the knobthorn tree. Huh. Look. Not the actual flowered flowers, more the sort of the buds. That's really very cool. I should have picked that up, actually. Let's see if he'll eat the actual flowering bits or just the sort of budding bits. How is that not sore, little monkey, on your hands? Yeah, you see, they just want the buds. Wonder what it tastes like. We should try and eat one, actually. Would you like to eat one, Jandre? Mm. We'll try and find one and see what it tastes like. And to sit on something that spiky, I don't know, I think it looks like a ridiculous idea. Can you feel the wind, maybe, everybody? You can probably hear it coming through the microphone slightly. And just try and feel it. It's very pleasant, I must say. It just seems to be carrying the spring on it. Lovely cooling breeze. Or maybe you can hear in the background there the white-bellied sunbird stopped calling for the winter time, now starting to call again. And that, of course, the old world equivalent of the hummingbird. Very similar, iridescent, gorgeous colours. He's very peaceful, isn't he, Jandre? There we are. I'm so glad we've discovered what he's eating, and I'm equally glad we've discovered what the Steenbok was getting by on. So I was beginning to wonder. I didn't realize they were quite such good diggers. Why are you sighing, Jandre? Have you had enough of this monkey?
I cannot zoom in this high position.
Oh, I see. Let us head across to Jamie, who's using the latest innovation at Wild Earth, the detachable camera.
Coming to us? Look at how amazing this is. So, you've got a different perspective on things. This is the most exciting thing that has happened since... Well, the most exciting thing that's happened since maybe this morning when we had lion cubs drinking in the morning light. As you can see, Dave is off the vehicle. I'm getting off the vehicle now. The only thing we haven't quite mastered is the whole earpiece deal. So I'm sitting plugged into the vehicle. I'm now going to get out of the vehicle and I'm going to show you something since... Oh my goodness, I'm falling over. I want to show you something since we were talking about the size of the cub tracks, and I thought, well, we've got this new camera, well, we've got this new extension cable, we've got a way of getting off the vehicle. Let's get right down to track level and have a look at where the lions walked along the road to us earlier this morning. So this is what we are looking at here. How are you feeling there, Dave? Yeah. It looks like a heavy camera. Dave's got this whole camera set up. It's quite incredible. We've got the best of both worlds now, a drive and a bushwalk, as long as we stay within a very limited sphere of the vehicle. So have a look at these tracks here, because the entire Pride we saw... This is one of the... This is one of the adult lionesses here, but it's the young one. So it's quite a smallish track. That's the adult lioness track. And then over here are the little cub tracks. So there we go. This is one of the biggest cubs. Look how big their feet are already. Here's a little one. That's a little cub track. Sense of scale. Here's my hand to give you an idea as to just how big their little cub's feet are. With their massive gangly paws. And in fact, if we look a little bit further to where Dave is standing, which is going to be tricky for him. Sorry, Dave, but these are the nicest tracks. We've got the lioness here. And the smallest of the cub tracks, this is the smallest one here. Look at this. Look at a tiny one. There we go. Those are those tiny little toes. Fits into the corner of my hand between my forefinger and my thumb. Absolutely adorable. Next to adult lioness track, this is not Amber Eyes' track for certain, because Amber Eyes has feet almost the size of an adult male lion. She's got massive feet. So it just gives us a really, really nice perspective of scale in terms of the different cub tracks. So there we go. How cool is that? A perspective that actually allows us to basically jump off the vehicle. Admittedly, not very fast. We can't do it straight away, and we can't get back onto the vehicle without a sort of great deal of rocking and so on. So we're going to carry on. We know where these lions have gone because we've just come from them, and we'll make our way back towards that sighting when there's a bit more space for us, so when all the other vehicles have had a chance. Now, since Dave can't jump back onto the vehicle and do everything with us still live, we're going to send you back over to James for now, and we'll catch up with you shortly, probably on the back of the vehicle.
We're just getting into position here because Gendre is getting peckish. He's had his banana already and he's very hungry, and he gets cranky when he's hungry, so I'm going to feed him something. And we normally have the bark of these trees. Gendre, I'm going to have to go around the back, I'm afraid. He's very cross with me when I do that. And normally what we do is we chop off the bark of these acacia trees and we try and taste that. And we have done that quite a lot, but here, this elephant, the elephant that took this apart, went specifically for the roots. You can see totally avoided all the top part of this black monkey thorn tree, that's Acacia burkeyi, or Vachilia burkeyi these days, and went straight for the root bark. So let's see if we can get a good taste of the root bark, and then Gendre cannot be a cranky chap. It's very unfair. Gendre is probably the least cranky person in the camp. Gendre, that was a compliment, in case you missed it. Yes, I'm so nice. My niceness overwhelms me even sometimes. There you are. What's it like, Gendre?
A little bit tanny.
Is it? You're not dead, though. That's horrible. It really isn't nice at all. It's not nearly as nice as the bark. Also, though, I think once a tree gets damaged, it produces tannin, so it's possibly tastes a bit better when the elephants had at it immediately. I could get around the front, Gendre. I'm so sorry. I didn't think that I could, but I could. We still haven't quite made it to Sydney's dam yet. Isn't that cool to be able to get off the car now with the camera? I think it's a really good idea. And I bet Gendre that he wouldn't be able to organize it within a week. And I've lost my bet. I'm very happy to have lost the bet. Where have I put my pouch? Oh, there it is. We're okay. We're okay, everybody. Sorry. Sorry. There we go. Hello, Angelo in Polokwane. Nice to hear from you from Polokwane. That's, in case you don't know everybody, just north of Pretoria, about 200 kilometers or so north of Pretoria, 250. Gendre is now opening a nachi so that he can eat it. He didn't like that acacia. Angelo, you say, are all the buds and things here non-poisonous? Can we eat anything? Not really. Most of the trees you could eat, well, you can taste. I mean, I wouldn't eat them. I think a lot of them have got so much tannin that they would harm our bodies. Gendre, I don't want your nachi, but it's going to fall off. And Angelo, there are a couple of bulbs and things, though, that I wouldn't go near. There are some berries I wouldn't eat. And certainly there are some things like the tambuchi tree, for example, which you absolutely couldn't go near. You'd be in big trouble if you tried to eat that. So there are one or two, but by and large, the leaves you can sort of taste and yeah, you're not going to have any trouble. Just one or two that would be desperately toxic. And some of the, certainly something, there's something called a bouffane distichia, which produces a gorgeous sort of, well, it doesn't, the description's not going to sound gorgeous, but it looks like a toilet brush, a bright red toilet brush coming out of the ground. And that has got an extremely toxic bulb. You need to be careful of that. We're just arriving at the water hole now. Let's see what we can find here. Perhaps some elephant. No, looks pretty clear, Gendre. But certainly they have rejigged the wall so that when this predicted deluge caused by La Niña comes, none of these dams are going to wash away. If La Niña does not do as she was predicted to have done, well, there's going to be quite a lot of earth moved for not much reason. I don't see anything there, Gendre, but I do see Swainson's spur fowl off to the right there. If you'd be so good as to train your lens upon it. There we are. Also searching amongst the elephant dung. And you can see very clearly why he's called a spur fowl there. You see the spur on the back of the legs, used for fighting. Why he's had to eat behind where we're looking, I don't know. It's very irritating. Right, let me just turn round slightly. Well, you can't really turn round slightly, can you, Gendre? You either turn round or you don't. It's like being dead or pregnant, everyone. One cannot be a little bit of either. One either is or isn't. I am neither. Right, we'll have a quick look here at the magpie shrike. Oh, no, let's not have a look at the magpie shrike. As we stopped here, Jamie Patterson managed to find something, well, if not quite as colourful, much more spectacular.
Spectacular indeed, and actually we didn't so much find them as they nearly found us while we were off the vehicle busy looking at lion tracks. I did hear them cracking branches a little bit away from us, and we only had to drive a couple of meters before we bumped into this spectacular elephant herd. Before we start chatting about the elephant and just on the subject of our off-the-camera process, there was a point at which when Dave was getting back onto the vehicle that the camera was upside down, so be very glad that we did that all off-air because you would have been slightly motion sick. However, we do owe a tremendous thank you to our camera operator team. I believe Mr. Hendry had a bet going with Gendre. I'm not sure if he's mentioned that or not. There was definitely a discussion that involved... he has discussed it. Good. So in that case, I think that James will be paying up. Will he not? And I think we owe the camera operators an enormous thank you for that, because it's a fantastic new perspective on things. And it allows us to do what we would do with guests normally. I always used to get my guests out of the vehicle and jump off and show them things and get them to come and walk and feel and touch. We haven't quite got to the feel and touch part of it yet. Technology hasn't quite caught up with us. I feel as though the next thing will be a scratch and sniff book. I've mentioned that before. A scratch and sniff book. So we can just basically say to you, okay, turn to page 80 for elephant dung smell. Give it a scratch, and that's what you would be smelling if you were on the safari with us. But we're getting step by step, we are getting closer to that magical moment of really recreating the safari experience. Little elephant, would you mind if I reposition? Because you are now very much behind a tree. Let's give it a go. They are slowly on their way towards us, so it might be nice to just sit and wait patiently. As you saw with the lioness, when you give the animals the opportunity to move to you rather than the other way around, then you generally have the most spectacular of views. Come on, guys. Here we go. They're slowly making their way towards us. What a wonderful morning it has been. Lion cubs, a herd of elephants. Tentatively, this youngster's tentatively approaching the other one. I think it wants whatever's being fed upon there. Not quite brave enough to approach. Lots of little ones here. I haven't actually seen that many adult females. We must have just caught the tail end of the herd. I think a lot of them have moved off further into the Mulwati drainage line. Just the peaceful munching sounds. I'm going... Oh, that's lovely. Hello, you are beautiful. Well, Zach... Just talking about their diet, Zach would like to know how on earth they manage to digest all of that bark and wood and leaves that they eat. And the answer is relatively inefficiently. So they do have incredible digestive systems that work very, very rapidly. And it does require a great deal of water, which is why elephants are generally very water dependent. And because their digestive system works as quickly as it does, it passes through quickly and they need a lot of water in order to process everything that's happening in their digestive tract. They are what's known as hindgut fermenters, which means that the bacteria is what basically works in harmony with them in order to break down the byproducts of the plant. So basically cellulose is what they are very, very good at digesting. They're busy breaking, the bacteria breaks it down in their guts, and that is what produces, like zebra, that's what produces the copious amounts of gas as a byproduct. And it, as I said, an inefficient system. So they, an adult elephant can eat up to 300 kilograms of food, and they excrete about a third of that a day. A third to half, depending on their digestive system. I've noticed quite a few, this is going to sound like a strange observation, I've noticed quite a few elephants have diarrhea, which I have never seen before. I have never seen so many elephants with diarrhea. And the only thing I can think of is that the poor nutrient contents of the food that they're eating and the unfamiliar plants, things like magic guarries that they're busy snacking on, I think is playing a bit of havoc, wreaking a bit of havoc with their digestive tracts. Which is such a pity because the last thing they need on top of trying to survive during this drought is then to have stomach complaints on top of it. Oh, you're so beautiful. I just looked right down this elephant's throat. They've got such fascinating mouth structures. That lower lip. Surprisingly nimble. And then of course the combination of the trunk as well. Come here, little one. You are truly beautiful. Pushing the tree out of the way to get to the slightly greener shoots underneath. Sarah, welcome on our sunrise safari. It is lovely to hear from you. Sarah's watching in Florida and would like to know if these are African bush elephants or if they are forest elephants and what is the difference between the two. These are savannah elephants, so African bush elephants. There's been a great deal of debate as to whether or not African forest elephants and African savannah elephants are different species or different subspecies. It's been concluded, as far as I know, although it's probably still up for a matter of debate, that they are the same species and they're not quite distinct enough to be classified as subspecies. Look at this, Dave. Look what's coming down the road towards us. There's the rest of the herd. Slowly but surely making their way. I think they're going to go to Juma Dam for a drink. Oh, photobomb. Oh, this is going to be beautiful. We're in such a good position here. So, Sarah, differences with forest and savannah elephants. The forest elephants often have quite straight, almost downward-facing tusks, whereas the savannah elephants often have slightly upwards curving tusks. They are ever so slightly smaller on average. And they actually tend to be much shyer. Oh, I think there's a big bull coming in. Oh. No, sorry, it's just a very, very big female. So those are the main differences. I have never seen a forest elephant. It's on my list of things I would love to see. There is, of course, a very small population in South Africa in the Knysna forests. So small that nobody actually knows exactly how many there are, but there's definitely confirmed forest elephants there. And then a lot of them towards Central Africa, Gabon area. I've only ever seen savannah elephants, and they are definitely high up on my list. Probably my favourite thing to sit and watch for extended periods of time. Something's happening here. You can see it in their body language. They're having some kind of conversation. Possibly grouping around a youngster. Some of them might be having a little bit of a nap. You can see that protective circle, protective huddle that they've formed. No feeding happening, just relatively aimlessly in the middle of the road. Excuse me. I think they're slowly making their way towards Juma Dam for a drink. Our little photo bomber is right in front of us now. Come on, big girls. It's all right. Now if we just sit here patiently, I'm hoping that they're all going to come streaming past the vehicle along the road. What I've done, in terms of good elephant practice, is I've moved off the road and out of the direct line that they're going to be coming past. They're essentially giving them space and not blocking their path in any way, in the hope that they will be happy to walk past us. One female's a little bit on edge at the back, the big cow, but the rest of them are perfectly relaxed. Hello, you. Look, they look like they're looking up at her, like she's talking to them. Welcome to David Leon, while we wait for our elephant herd to move up the road towards us. I'm going to keep turning back to make sure that they're not sneaking up behind me. David, yes, we do know, we know exactly where we are in Africa this is happening. We are in a place called Juma Private Game Reserve. So you can Google Juma, D-J-U-M-A, and it's in a place called the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. So right up in the top northeastern corner of South Africa. And there's lovely things happening, so I'm not going to distract for too long. But it's lovely to have you on board. This is a live safari experience from the African bush, which makes it truly magical because it means that we never know exactly where our morning is going to go. We've already had a, and I'm sorry, David, to tell you this, we've already had a truly spectacular sighting this morning. Dave and myself, Dave is the cameraman, so he's the man behind the camera, and we spent the morning with 6 gorgeous little lion cubs, adult lionesses of the Nkuhuma Pride. We've moved out of that sighting for now to give other people a chance to go and see them, but at some point we will be back. So Dave, David, it is lovely to... No, it was David, right?
I think so.
It was David. I'm getting confused because Dave is the cameraman. I thought I was getting confused there. Sorry, David, Leon. I've got Dave the cameraman behind me and I got confused. We do this twice a day, every day, morning and afternoon, and we're very much looking forward to have you on board as a regular viewer. It is lovely to have you. Anything about this, of course, is you can find... Look at the little one. What's happening, baby? The amazing thing about this is because we do this twice a day, every day, we have got a whole host of animal characters that we have come to know and love, from the queen gorilla, the leopard that has this as her territory, to her daughters, her little, her brand new 7-month-old cubs. We've got lion cubs coming out of our ears at the moment. And of course, all of the other magnificent African creatures like these amazing elephants. Some lovely stuff happening with the youngsters of this herd. 2 little boys knocking noses. The little one on the right doesn't really have tusks to speak of. Just tiny little points starting to grow through. That hasn't stopped him from picking a little bit of a game with an older cousin. And this is why I love spending time with elephants. Always up to something interesting. And Carolyn. I want to join in. I want to join in. I want to play. Carolyn has said that he would love to know what they are saying to each other. It would be absolutely fascinating. Carolyn, I couldn't agree with you more. I do think that if I had to choose, if I had to pick one animal that I could be for a day, and just sort of communicate with them and talk to them and understand their lives. No photo bomber. Are we not paying you enough attention? You're having a big stretch first thing in the morning. She is determined that we're not going to pay too much attention to the other elephants, Dave. We better give her some love, since she's made it very clear that she would like to be on camera. Thank you very much, and fair enough. You are lovely, big girl. Hi. Stretching out her trunk, giving us a sniff. Just making sure that we aren't up to any mischief before walking right past us. A lovely girl. We are so incredibly fortunate. A lovely, lovely question coming through from Susan with a relatively complicated answer. She wants to know, when do the youngsters move from becoming the protected to the protectors of the herd? Which is a stunning question, because the answer is, even at 4 or 5 years old, especially with female calves, if you watch them, you'll often see them acting as a babysitter for the younger babies, often their younger siblings, but any little baby in the herd will have a whole host of babysitters, and the young females practice their mothering skills before they are old enough to have their own babies. However, when it comes to a really serious threat, then it is only the adult females, you're sort of looking at around 15 and older, that will take a step up and really form that protective circle on the outskirts of the herd. And that's almost invariably, in fact, that is invariably managed and communicated by the older females in the group. And there'll probably be at least one elephant here. Not a big girl. That is at least over 40 years old. So decades of experience. Don't know where to look in this particular sighting. Hi, guys. Okay, they're going to come walk right past the vehicle. Dave, you know the drill. Nice slow movements. They're not showing us any sign of aggression. Hello, girls. Hey, beautifuls. Hi. Here we go. Hey, guys. Can you not have a fight right next to us? Please, and thank you. Little bit of a scuffle there between a female and a young male, pushing and shoving a little bit. Hey guys, don't forget I'm here, please. I know you're busy having a conversation, but I would prefer it if you would remember that I was here. Okay, we've just got to stick this one out. We've just got to sit still and let them sort it out amongst themselves. Elephants have an amazing perception of space, and if we turn on the vehicle now, we're just going to upset them. There's a big female, like the ones I was talking about. She will be at least 30 years old. Those deep, amazing rumbles. Hello, Ellies. How's it going? Beautiful big girl. Giving us an awe-inspiring demonstration of her strength here. I'm quite glad we're parked here. Not in the way of that thorn tree, because she's quite determined to snap most of it off. Oh, after all that, there's a bit of a piddly branch. Hello, what have you got to say for yourself? Hello, little one. You've got to be a little girl. If you were a little boy, you would have given us a head shake. Yeah, it's a little girl. Oh no, sorry, my mistake, it's a little boy. I thought we were going to get a bit of a head shake and some cheekiness. Now, you'll notice I'm keeping my voice relatively low, soft and low pitched. I talk to the elephants, not because they understand what I'm saying, but just because it's a good way of communicating my intention to them. So I'm basically telling them through tone that we mean absolutely no harm to their precious little ones. Like this little one in front. Look at this little one. Oh, oh, you got very brave there for a second. We're absolutely surrounded at this point. We've got massive females right up close to the vehicle, and this is my favorite. There is nothing, there are no words on earth that can describe this feeling. Oh, Big girls. Hi. Is that yummy, big girl? Dave, just be aware you've got an elephant right behind you. Don't move too quickly. And throughout this entire sighting, there has not been one single sign of aggression from these elephants towards us. Not even raised ears. Oh. This cow is seriously focused, intently focused on breaking this acacia tree. And it's fighting back. Hello, elephant. Big girl. Okie dokie. And while we let our Ellies feed peacefully, let's find out if Mr. Hendry is having as an amazing morning as we are.
I'm going to have to say no, not quite as amazing. I'm rather jealous of that elephant sighting, I must say. Our little elephant sighting didn't last very long. It was very wonderful, but it didn't last quite as long as hers. So I'm very jealous. Anyway, it's just the way the cookie crumbles sometimes, Jandre. It's the way the tambourti hits the ground, as it were. Anyway. We'll see what we can find through here. We've had a very good birding morning. Excellent rattling cisticola sighting, wouldn't you say, Jandre? The best. And the Wahlbergs. But I have failed to find any further leopard tracks, everyone. I was rather hoping that they would turn up. Mulberry tree over here. Let's do that and then we'll come back to that very nice herd of Impala. Righty. Now I've come past this tree once to see a leopard in it. And every time I come past again, I think, well, surely there must be. This might be quite a good tree, Jandre, to climb, don't you think?
Yes. Splendid.
Yes, I think probably not now. Yes. We've also seen giant eagle owls in there. Mvula and Karula in the tree together. But now, it's just withering leaves. So, Jandre was asking me why it is we went underneath the jackalberry tree a little bit earlier. And Jandre said to me, why it is that because that's how Jandre speaks, he says, why it is that the jackalberry tree has got yellow leaves now, pray tell, O wise one. And I said to him, my son, the reason that it has got yellow leaves at this time of the year, seemingly in juxtaposition with the freshness of the season, is that it is what we call semi-deciduous, which means that it does not have a deciduous cycle, like a knobthorn, for example. It has a cycle of its own, where it will lose its leaves at odd intervals throughout the year, sometimes in the middle of summer. Right, there's some nice impalas here. Let us go and have a look at them. Get our impala sighting in for the day, eh, Jandre? Important to do that every day. I don't think these are too far from where the lions are, actually. Maybe one of them will be eaten. Which will be inescapably unpleasant for the impala, but, well, for us. Hello. Now, what you can see, most certainly now, is that the females are pregnant and they're starting to show. You see that, Jandre?
Yes.
Let's go a little bit further. There are a whole lot more in front of us. In pretty good condition, I'd say. Good shiny fur. No ribs showing, really, and some of them, maybe one or two of them, but not many. I took a picture, Jean-André. It's extremely average. No, be silly. Now, let's try and figure out what that impala is eating. Because we worked out what the Steenbok was eating. Now, that's eating plain sort of shoots of grass. But they're very old shoots, which means that the amount of ruminating that thing must be doing is extensive. Looking a little bit thin, but really bad. And of course we know that the impala are particularly good at surviving drought conditions because they browse and graze. Whereas most are one or the other. Definitely clean. I mean, it's been quite selective over what it's eating. It's pushing out bits and pieces of stick from the way. Oh, they are wonderful animals. And they're attended there, Jean-André. A fork-tailed dronga, the one you were on, I think. Were you not on the same one I was on? No. They all look so alike. I think it's gone now. You got it. Freddy the fork-tailed drongo. Or Duncan the drongo. Is it Freddy? Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay. He's got that notch in his tail, the fork.
That black feather.
And the black feather, yeah. Okay, good. All right, let's move on a little bit. I'm not so sure about your identification of Freddy the fork-tailed drongo there. Ah, I can see where the lions were. We're not going to go in there, everybody, because you've had a good time with them, and we've had a good time with them, and they're already two vehicles looking at them, but I can see in the bushes there where they are. Very good for the afternoon. It means we will be able to go and spend some more time with those marvelous little cubs. And I'm just confirming, I think you only had the six cubs, correct? And the two that came for a drink sometime during the night were not found this morning. Is that right, Luisi? Right. So it was difficult to see who was in the thicket and who wasn't. Now, this is a good place for a lion to be, and indeed I believe it to be a place that lions are quite often. That is around some of the last water that there is. Now, the water hole is just up here, across the dam wall, and in a time like this, the lions work out quite quickly that animals get a bit desperate about finding enough to drink, and so they start to concentrate their activities around this waterhole. And I don't think that it's any coincidence we've had those lions for so long. You know, we've had them on just about every single drive, and if we haven't, it's only been because we haven't found them. They've been on this property, and I think it's because they're focusing their activities on this path here, because they know that animals have to come and drink, and therefore there is going to be something around here when they want to come by to catch it, something to eat. What can you see? It's all very well pointing blindly at the sun, Jean-André, but I need to see what you see. There we are. Jean-André spotted some dwarf mongoose, everybody. All he did was extend one finger sort of blithely at the middle distance and expected me to figure out what he'd seen. But there they are. Very nice. How are we living? I think probably. What do you think? There's a bit of a mound there, Jean-André. There might be one or two holes that they're living in, keeping their civilized hours. There's some youngsters there, some very small ones. And I think they're fossicking up and down the sort of bank because the soil is disturbed, which means that it's easier to get into. They can find the old scorpion or beetle grub, or maybe even if they're very lucky, a spider or an egg even. I imagine when ground gets disturbed like this, reptile eggs and that sort of thing get, that sort of thing gets disturbed. Hello, Books to Give. You hoping to see mongoose today? Well, I'm very pleased that we have been able to show you some mongoose, as opposed to mongooses. And in the background you can hear the call of the crested barbet. Now for a little dwarf mongoose, although life looks quite leisurely and you come out of the mound when the sun comes up and you go down before it, as the sun goes down, and you stay safe and keep fairly sort of civilized hours, what you find is that if you're that size, you've got to eat almost continuously. And so every day is a bit of a challenge to find sufficient to maintain your metabolism. And there's lots of looking around every single rock and bush and log and piece of bark, or bits and pieces to eat. And their major predators in this particular area, of course, will be Mr. and Mrs. Wahlberg, who are not far from here, and shortly to have to feed more than just themselves, Jean-André. For the last 3 minutes, everybody, I think I just want to go around the corner, Jean-André, if you don't mind, see if we can't get a view of that amazing crested barbet, because I can actually see the bird. And we had such a good sighting of a crested barbet this morning that we missed on account of the lions being all over the place. And the crested barbet, a humble bird, but really good looking. You can see it there. Too far. Let's go around the corner here. Do you want it here? We've got him there. He's the bird in that tree. There we are. Well done. Oh, look at him. He's so sweet. With his little crest up in the wind, he's listening to the other barbets calling. There's one calling behind him and one in front of him, sharpening his beak a bit. And one of the only birds that's able to dig its own hole in a tree to go and live in. Most will go, tree nesting birds will go and live in the hole of a woodpecker or perhaps a barbet itself. There he was calling a little bit. He's got bed hair, you see that, Jean-André? In fact, always a crested barbet looks a little bit like he's got bed hair. All right, everybody, that is going to be it from us this morning. We'll see you this afternoon at 1600 hours. No, we won't. At 1500 hours at 3 o'clock Central African time. Thank you, Jean-André, for your efforts today. Well done. Yes, a big thank you to Louise and Jerry in the final control, and of course to Jamie Patterson and her, was David, was it? Yes. We'll see you later, and thank you for joining us on this drive. Bye-bye.